I'm Elex Michaelson. This week, the issue is guns in California. Attorney General Rob Bonta is with us to talk about his push for new regulations for concealed carry permits. Then, the issue is police reform in the wake of Tyre Nichols' death. Can legislation actually pass Congress? And the issue is Nikki Haley running for president, challenging her old boss. Our panel this week, on the left, Democratic activist Shane Harris. On the right, former Trump staffer John McEntee. The issue is starts right now.
Broadcasting across California, you're watching The Issue Is.
And welcome to The Issue Is. Standing by right there, the Attorney General of California. In the wake of multiple mass shootings, once again, guns top of mind. This week, the state's top Democrats proposing legislation to further regulate concealed carry permits. Last year, the U.S. Supreme Court's conservative majority threw out some of California's previous rules in the so-called Bruen case.
Gun safety saves lives. More guns, more lives lost. The data is overwhelming.
SB2 would enhance existing licensing and training to get a concealed carry permit. It require you to be 21 and identify certain sensitive public places where you could not carry a weapon. Those include government buildings, schools, medical facilities, public transit, places of worship, parks, playgrounds, and bars. Attorney General Rob Bonta is one of those leading the way on this issue. He joins us now from Sacramento. Mr. Attorney General, welcome back to The Issue Is.
Thanks for having me, Elex. Honored to be here.
So why is this legislation specifically necessary? Is there much evidence that concealed carry permit holders are actually the ones performing mass shootings?
There is strong evidence supporting the need for this law, and there's also a new Supreme Court decision, Bruen, which requires this approach in SB2. And the U.S. Supreme Court issued a decision last summer that changed the way the Second Amendment has been interpreted for many, many years. And it said that when you have a concealed carry weapon regulatory law like California has, it can focus on two things. One, it can have robust reviews of the safety of the individual seeking the concealed carry weapon permit, and it can identify sensitive sites, places where children play, where alcohol is served, where other constitutional rights are being exercised, where you can restrict the use of a concealed carry weapon. And that's exactly what we've done here. So we believe this is a Bruen compliant law, and the law around permitting of, or the data around the permitting of guns in different states shows that when you have less restrictive or right to carry approaches, where more guns are given to more people without some sort of robust review of the safety of the individual, then gun violence goes up. And that is very important data.
But have any of the recent mass shooters been people with concealed carry permits?
Of every mass shooting in the history of the United States, I'm sure there were all varieties of people with permits or without, with concealed carry, who got them legally or illegally. I think the most important data to know is that when you don't have any regime at all, when you give out CCWs to anyone who seeks them without any safety evaluation, or when you are very loose and don't have a robust review, more people get killed and there is more gun violence in those states.
You know, this is obviously a very emotional issue for a lot of people. I want to give you an opportunity to respond to some of the opposition. On the Fox 11 News special report this week, my colleague Marla Tejas and I spoke with Russell Stewart, who sells guns, runs security firms, and I asked him for his direct message to you. Here it is.
Well, my message to the Attorney General is let's actually focus on the mental health side. Us in the gun and security industry actually agree. We want to be able to sell a firearm to people that legally should have them and not have anyone get them that should not have them. We completely agree on that. But when you start getting into saying things like, you don't need to carry a firearm at your daughter's soccer game. Well, I do remember Congressman Steve Scalise, who was shot at a baseball diamond, where he was never going to, you know, expect to be shot, especially being around Secret Service agents. You're only simply making it more difficult for law-abiding people to protect themselves and their families when obviously no criminal is going to follow these laws.
What's your response to Russell Stewart?
That we have to follow the data and the evidence around loss of life due to gun violence. And it is clear, more guns in more places means more gun violence and more gun death. It's also clear that when you have unrestrictive or less restrictive CCW or permitting approaches, more people die. There is more gun violence. What is also true is that in California, where we have some of the strongest gun safety laws in the nation, we also have one of the lowest firearm mortality rates. The data, the numbers, they don't lie, Alex. And that's what we have to rely on when we're making policy. And one individual might think mental health is the solution. Show me your data. Prove it. Show me the evidence, and also prove that that is the only component causing gun violence. We need to be ambitious enough and focused enough and committed enough to do everything that is constitutionally compliant and permissible to save lives and save unnecessary death from senseless gun violence. And any one of our laws, someone can point to it and say, that doesn't save every potential scenario of gun violence. And you know what? They're right, but it can save many. Lives in many scenarios, and then the next law layered on top of that saves more lives, and then the next law layered on top of that that's constitutionally compliant, that one saves more lives, and together they create a set of laws, a constellation of laws, an aggregation of laws that make people safer, and the data proves it.
I mean, that's what some of them would say is that this essentially is harming the good guys who go through the rules, follow the rules, have the guns safely, and then they end up in a situation where somebody who's not following the rules and they can't protect their family. What do you say to them?
Yes, that's what they say. That's what they've said. That's what they'll continue to say, and they will continue to be wrong. We need to do everything that keeps people safe, including having rules and regulations to make sure that responsible law-abiding individuals are the ones who have guns, and including concealed carry weapons. The U.S. Supreme Court in Bruen says that states can take appropriate steps to make sure that only law-abiding responsible people carry their weapons. And we also need to make sure that those who are involved in illegal gun trafficking, that we are having operations to interdict those that trafficking and stopping the illegal flow of guns. We need to do that too. But please don't tell me that just because someone is able to get a gun illegally, then we should throw out every law that saves life, that the evidence shows prevents senseless gun violence. We need to do it all.
We do want to have a little bit of fun before you go to get to know you a little bit better. We've been honoring recently the late, great Barbara Walters by asking her favorite questions. These are rapid fire, one sentence answers. First thing that pops into your mind. Okay, here we go. What is your motto or philosophy?
No one will ever outwork me.
What is the biggest misconception about you?
I think some people put me in a box in terms of my ideology, but I'm open to evidence, interested in argument, and willing to do whatever's best for the most people.
Finish this sentence. Attorney General Rob Bonta is...
1,000% committed to lifting up every Californian and making their lives better in every way possible.
All right. Attorney General Rob Bonta, always great to see you. Thanks so much for joining us on The Issue Is.
Thanks for having me, Alex. Honored to be with you.
Up next, our panel standing by. You see him right there. Shane Harris on the left, John McEntee on the right. We go to break with images from the above Los Angeles Instagram. Here's a look at Lake Arrowhead after all our recent rain. How beautiful is that?
We demand that Congress pass the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act. Joe Biden will sign it.
Vice President Kamala Harris speaking at Tyre Nichols' funeral this week in Memphis and pushing for Congress to pass the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act, which looks very difficult to do politically. Let's talk about that and more with our panel. Excited to have him here for the very first time. The Reverend Shane Harris is here. He is the founder of the People's Association of Justice Advocates based in San Diego and Washington. He has met with all the biggest names in Democratic Party, including the president there, focused on issues of civil rights and human rights, even meeting with Kevin McCarthy there, some bipartisan. John McEntee is back. He served as one of President Trump's closest aides. He was the personal aide to the president and the director of the White House Office of Presidential Personnel. He's also the founder of the Right Stuff app, which is a dating app geared towards conservative singles. You can download it for free right now at daterightstuff.com. And maybe by the end of this,
Shane will sign up. Who knows? I mean, maybe. You never know where, what kind of love you might find there. Shane, John, welcome to you both. Thanks so much for being here.
Thanks for having us. Beer. I was going to say I'm looking for a wife, so.
Okay. maybe on there. Who knows? So let's talk about this idea, though, of police reform, Shane, which is obviously something you've thought a lot about in the wake of what happened with Tyre Nichols. It's hard to imagine this George Floyd Justice and Policing Act passing, though.
I was there in Washington, D.C. this week, and it is going to be an uphill battle, I can assure folks. I think that one of the main reasons why is because of the qualified immunity portion of the bill.
And what does that mean for people that haven't heard that before?
Well, qualified immunity is essentially a major protection for police, and it puts those protections in place so that the police officer is not personally liable for what took place.
Right.
And I think the qualified immunity aspect is going to be a big uphill battle for those of us who are trying to negotiate. We need to negotiate more smart on this.
Meaning you may have to give up on that in order to get everything else.
I some folks might slight me on this, but I think that we might have to look at possibly, you know, just like the First Step Act, we might have to look at getting a first step to this police reform push and a second step and a third step, but we got to get what we can do now.
John, do you think that police reform is necessary now?
No, I don't. I think the only reform we need is to raise the standards in policing. I think what we've seen is the effect of lowering the standards. I think demonizing the police makes people retire, makes people not want to join, brings less qualified people into the mix. Maybe it has to do with training. Maybe it has to do with a lot of things. But I think most conservatives think it has to do with raising the standards. And I don't think a bill is going to pass. I don't think Republicans will feel the same pressure they did in 2020. There's not the same outcry. Obviously, this was a horrible tragedy, but I don't see something like that making any headway in Washington.
I have to disagree, Alex. I mean, we are looking at a crisis in this country when it comes to black men specifically, and the communities across this country, whether Republican, Democrat, are very concerned about the fact that taxpayer dollars are going to have to keep being dealt out on these large lawsuits. And on top of that, I think it's the humanity question of our country, just like we had on the First Step Act. Do we keep going down this timeline of allowing and seeing black men in this country be murdered and killed by police when they're sent to our communities to protect and serve? There is a real question on the federal level regarding this.
Well, let's talk a little bit more about the First Step Act. This is something that President Trump did in a bipartisan way. I know you were very close with President Trump. Why do you think he was able to get that done? And what do you think are the lessons that can be learned from that experience?
The big takeaway is obviously that the president was willing to work with the other side. I think that says a lot about him being a reasonable president. I think anybody needs to do that that wants to get something done. I don't think the effects of the First Step Act are completely known. I think a lot of people have been let down by it, especially conservatives. So I think maybe we're not on a long enough timeline, but I think it hasn't had the exact effect we thought it would. I don't know if that necessarily means more reform or maybe taking a step back and reviewing that.
And as a Democrat, that's something that you worked with the Trump administration on. Yeah. What do you think can be learned from that?
Well, I mean, I was in the front cover of the Washington Post with Vivica A. Fox, Van Jones, I was there with, who invited me to the White House for the signing. And one of the things, I think, key aspects of that bill was that it was bipartisan. There were things that had to be left out in order for it to get passed. One of those things was cash bail reform. And, you know, there was a number of other things that Democrats had to be willing to be reasonable as far as being flexible on. So the same things that took place with the First Step Act, and I remember Van Jones looking at CNN and saying, this is a first step. For those of you who are angry that you didn't get everything you wanted, you never get everything you wanted.
Right.
But working with the other side of the aisle, something really great was accomplished for this country, and it was signed by President Trump, and it was Jared Kushner, who I had the chance to talk to at the White House, who was very pivotal in working with both sides of the aisle to get this done. So I think we need that back in this country again. We need civility back at the core of our and the fabric of our politics again.
All right. Well, up next, we're going to talk about your old boss. Does former President Trump still have a hold on the national GOP as we play some Smokey Robinson? Our panel will be back to talk about that. Nikki Haley entering the race. But we first, above Los Angeles Instagram, taking us this time above Lake Hollywood, which is also looking really nice after our recent rain. Former South Carolina Governor Nikki Haley is reportedly running for the GOP presidential nomination in 2024, challenging Donald Trump, set to announce in a few weeks. Of course, she served as Trump's UN ambassador. I talked about that this week on Fox 11 Los Angeles with Trump's former communications director, Anthony Scaramucci.
They're great people. She's a great American. She would be a great president. It's very tough to beat Donald Trump. He's a beast on the debate stage, and he has a way of demeaning people, and politicians, for whatever reason, they can't handle that from him.
So let's talk about this and more with our panel. Back with us, former Trump advisor John McEntee, founder of the Right Stuff dating app. Also with us, we've got Shane Harris, a Democratic activist. John, Nikki Haley, somebody you worked with. What do you make of her entering the race?
I like Scaramucci. I disagree with him. I think Nikki Haley is a self-centered politician. I think she's seen her shot, and she's playing for VP. She knows a Trump-DeSantis war is coming. I think she's going to play it safe. I think it's a calculated move, and I think she's going to let them have at it.
What do you think that Trump would think about her entering?
I don't know. I think he's fine with any challenge. I think he knows it's going to be between him and DeSantis. I think the rest is kind of just noise. I've heard Pompeo, Pence, other people. He probably feels the more the merrier, but I don't think he thinks she's an actual threat.
So he doesn't see it as disloyalty?
It might be disloyalty. I mean, I think the fact that in 2016, when she was given the rebuttal to Obama, she spent the entire time attacking Trump showed kind of where she was. Somehow she got into the administration, and she left, you know, before the midterms and before things went south. So everything is kind of on her timeline, on her agenda, where she wants to see her career go. And this is the next logical step. I'll run for president.
What do you make of the GOP race right now?
Well, I think Nikki Haley is sharp. She's never lost a race. And she has obviously been the ambassador to the UN. She's got an impeccable record. And I think that she's going to be a major war to wage in the GOP.
Who do you think would be the toughest Republican for Democrats to run against?
Well, I think that's a good question. I think Nikki Haley is sharp. I think certainly Tim Scott. The Republican U.S. Senator would be someone that would South Carolina as well. The Republican Party would be smart to look at a very unique, different take on how the party could speak to a multiple bases of voters as opposed to just one channel of voters.
Who do you think would be the toughest Democrat for Republicans to beat?
I think it's still Joe Biden. He won. He's the current president. He has the brand. America doesn't do cringe. They're not going to vote for Kamala. I think he's tough to beat, an incumbent's tough to beat.
Well, next week is the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
And we've got a special show here on The Issue Is. Legendary sports broadcaster Bob Costas will be here in studio for the half hour. So we're thinking sports. Who do you got in the big game? Who's winning the Super Bowl?
You know, I mean, Patrick Mahomes is sharp, and the Chiefs obviously are Super Bowl champs, but I've got to go with the Eagles on this one. Chiefs are in the division that my team that I've always been loyal to, the Chargers, are in, so I can't back the Chiefs. I got to go with the Eagles in this one. But this is a historic Super Bowl. First time two black quarterbacks have faced each other in the Super Bowl. It's going to be very exciting. Very exciting Black History Month.
You're still loyal to the Chargers, even though they weren't so loyal to San Diego.
I'm still loyal to them.
John McEntee, former college quarterback, knows a lot about football. Who's going to win the Super Bowl?
I like Andy Reid. I'm going to go with the Chiefs. I think it's going to be a last-minute field goal to win it.
Okay, and most importantly, you know, the halftime show is going to be Rihanna.
Rihanna.
One of the questions is, will Drake perform with Rihanna? What do you think?
I think Drake is coming out of the bullpen.
What do you think?
I'll agree.
Okay, there we go. We found something they agree with there. Nice to have you both here. Thanks so much for coming on. Again, the right stuff. Maybe we'll find a wife there for you.
Yeah.
That would be a story. We have an inspiring story about homelessness and art when we come back. But first, here is some Drake and Rihanna. Seven in 10 Californians say homelessness is the biggest issue of concern in this state, according to a new PPIC poll out this week. In one of the most visited malls in LA, there's an interesting approach on display right now.
So this one here.
Artemis Patricia Ender Solterra is showcasing art she created while living on Skid Row.
Made me feel motivated and engaged.
She says painting is giving her new purpose.
It gives me hope for my future.
A nonprofit called The People Concerned taught Artemis to paint. They have an open studio on Skid Row.
I don't think many people know about this incredible work.
Rick Caruso visited the space during his campaign for LA mayor and was blown away.
The people living on the streets are not disposable. They're human beings. You know, I talked about that a lot, and we need to deal with them in a humane, decent, respectful way. And this shines a light on that.
That campaign visit gave him an idea.
We should do like an art show at the Grove.
Now, that idea is a reality. Caruso showcasing the artist's work at the Grove, his property, one of the most visited spots in all of Southern California.
The only thing I would tell you is you're at the Grove, so I would double the prices and collect more money.
The art is on display where you park and enter the Grove. It'll be here for the next month. It's all available for purchase, and all the proceeds go to the nonprofit.
I'm here presenting my piece.
Artist Gary Brown calls this his favorite work and says learning to paint changed him.
And it keeps me out of trouble.
John Masseri is CEO of The People Concerned and says this studio is a worthwhile investment.
Not only does it really help them rebuild their self-esteem, but it also is a way for them, you know, to know that they have meaning and worth and something to contribute. And I think artistic expression is a way not only to heal internally, but to be able to express that externally as well.
He loves to see his artists now getting the star treatment.
These are people who have been on the streets who have largely been invisible, have felt unseen.
No one is smiling bigger than Yamoki, whose art is heavily featured.
Is it pretty cool to have this here at the Grove for people to be looking at your artwork?
Yes, makes me so happy.
Makes you so happy.
Love seeing that. Nice work to all of them. That's all for this week. We'll see you next week with Bob Costas. Until then, the Above Los Angeles account taking us above downtown Los Angeles. Have a good one.